And tell you a little bit about the house and the foundation and all of us and what we do here. And then I'll tell you about some events we have coming up. So basically I'm going to kill time and try to entertain you for the next couple of minutes, if that's all right.
Sure.
So I'm Kelly, as I mentioned, I'm the executive director here. Trisha, the redhead that you met downstairs, is our tour director. We're both crazy, we work constantly. Those of you who are house lovers, and I know some of you are house volunteers elsewhere, so you have the same illness we do, where you know, just never leave this house to go to your home.
Yeah.
We both will have answers to any questions that you might have. We are open 5 days a week for tours, Wednesday through Sunday. We do guided tours. They're about an hour long at noon, 1, 2, and 3 p.m. We also do, much to the chagrin of my staff, 140 events a year.
Wow.
Thank you. When I came on board 5 years ago, we were doing between 25 and 30. And the staff hasn't left me. So that's a testament to them. And hope they must think I'm nice. I must be doing something. I don't know. But so those events and the tours and the events like this tonight are how we survive. This is what we're doing to try to become a sustainable organization, as opposed to many house museums throughout the country that, you know, we're losing 50 or 60 a year right now. They're closing because people aren't coming. So we are very grateful that you're here for that reason. So this house was built, they started construction in 1874. So she is 141 years old. They moved in 1876. So we're coming up on the 140th anniversary of them moving in. So just under 2 years to build this house. It's 4,000 square feet per floor. Yeah, I know. There are 7.5 stories. And some of the stories are half, you know, they're halfway down, but if for levels, there's 7.5 to 8. Trisha and I differ on that. I say 7.5, she says 8. At any rate, it's a big house, as you probably noticed when you approached it. The Hegler family and the Karras family, who were the second and third generations, lived in this house for 130 years. So we're just now 11 years without an occupant, aside from us. So they lived in this state. It was decorated in 1875, 1876, and when you do it right, you don't have to keep doing it over and over again. As you can see, we've had things like paint failure over the years. We were the first house in town that had bathrooms. The bathrooms were installed by a man named Levi Wolf, who was a pioneer in plumbing.
You see the white up there, the lovely white that's taking down all the trim?
That's what it looks like when you're under a bathroom in this house. Some of you can see another one right there. So when you have the only house in town with original plumbing, you know, you don't know when you've done it right until something goes wrong. So what they would do, and what the last occupant, Mr. Alvin Karras, did, and he was born here, by the way, in 1901, and he died here in 2003, just shy of his 103rd birthday. So there's longevity in the family. My board chair is 89, and he's still going strong. He runs circles around me. But at any rate, when Alvin was about 80 years old, it would be the 1980s. In the 1980s, houses like this, you know, we'd just come through the oil crisis, so heating was probably not fun. It still isn't. But homes like this were not being saved. In fact, in his lifetime, in that 100 years, or initially that 80 years, and then 90 years, and 100 years, he saw his friends' homes torn down all over the country. People were walking away from places like this. There were four others in the neighborhood that are gone. There were four homes that Matheson, you know Matheson Park? There were four homes out there that are gone. Prairie Avenue in Chicago, something like 80% of those homes are gone. So this is what he saw happening. So when Alvin had a leak in a bathroom, he'd fix the leak, but not the damage below, because he presumed that his family, upon his death, having no heirs, no children, that his nieces and nephews would tear this house down. And that was the plan until 1995, when we took over. And I mentioned he lived till 2003, so we had a foundation operating a museum in his home while he still lived here. He gave us the house in 1995, as long as we promised to save the house, never kick him out of his house, and not get rid of anything that he owned. So somewhere in this house is Alvin's junk drawer, his toothbrush, his comb, his underwear. We have everything because that was the deal we signed. So that's a little bit about who we are and how we acquired the house. So here we are 10 years later having events, inviting people in. We're so grateful you're here. In the last 5 years, we've tripled our visitation, which is nice. That's what that 140 events do. So it's a lot of work, but it definitely helps us to be here and to stay around. We are a National Historic Landmark. There are only about 3,000 National Historic Landmarks in the country. There are 25 or 30,000 on the National Register. So this is a higher distinction. So we are held in the same category as a lot of the president's homes, as the Grand Canyon, as Mount Rushmore is a National Historic Landmark. So it's a very high distinction. And the reason we have it is because of the architecture, number one, the manufacturing things that Mr. Hegler invented, and the progress of manufacturing is number two. And then number three is we have a history of philosophy in this house, specifically interreligious dialogue. So they were trying to bring about peace by getting different religions to talk to each other, which is not unheard of and probably should work if we could ever accomplish it. So that is a little bit about us. I will tell you about some of our upcoming events. We have tomorrow, any of you with little ones, or even yourselves might enjoy it, we have a visit from St. Nicholas. Father Dominic, is it Garamone or Garamone? He's the bread monk. Are you familiar with the bread monk? He used to be on PBS. He's from here. He works at St. Bede Abbey. He lives there. He is one of the monks at St. Bede Abbey. And he likes to do first-person narratives, so he will be St. Nicholas tomorrow. He'll be talking about the traditions and you know, why St. Nicholas is important. It'll be very fun. Very family-appropriate, so bring little ones. On December 11th, Tricia, who you met downstairs, what you might not know about her is she's an amazing storyteller, really incredible storyteller. She is curating for us her favorite stories from the wintertime. You hear in the Christmas carol, there'll be scary ghost stories and tales of the glories of Christmases long, long ago. Well, scary stories were originally meant for Christmas because it's dark at 3 o'clock in the afternoon and you need to huddle up around a fire. And so she's curating some of her favorites for that. And she's done it a couple years now, and it's really, really fun. It gives you a different view of some Christmas stories. The following weekend, the 18th and 19th, this is a really fun event. These are our holiday vignettes. And what we do is we have actors. We have all sorts of friends who are actors, luckily, musicians. And they will be playing different characters in each room on this floor of the house. And you are guided on a tour. And you're guided because it's a play. So the play unfolds as you go from room to room. And it is so much fun. And this year, it's a comedy. And I think it's pretty hilarious. I mean, we've been cramping ourselves up for weeks while we're writing it and doing it. And it's based, a lot of it is around The Help. So any of you are Downton Abbey fans? Where are my peeps? Oh, yeah. So we have a Downton Abbey type story, but it's very comical because, of course, The Help doesn't want the family to know that there's something going on downstairs, which is, it's a blast. Tickets for that are on sale right now. Well worth it. If you can come back and see us for that, I think you'll really, really enjoy it. So, are there any questions on anything I haven't answered? I want to kill another minute or two just in case. Yes?
How much is your guided tours?
Our guided tours are $10 a person, and that covers this level of the house and the ground floor, and it takes an hour. There are 57 rooms in the entire house. We can't see them all in an hour. And that's about all the stamina most people have for listening to me. Sometimes even less. Are any of you ready for me to stop? We do also do whole house tours, though. The whole house tour is 3.5 hours long. It is from top to bottom or bottom to top, whichever you prefer. We do ask for a reservation and some advance notice because it will be taking one of our staff members out of commission for half a day. And those are $100 a piece. But if you love architecture and old houses, I've never had anybody ask for their money back. In fact, they usually at the end are giving us more, going, this is awesome, you guys are just, and we love that part. So, yes, so those are our tours. We do outdoor concerts all summer every Friday on our lawn. Those are just $5. It's like going to Ravinia, only you have a lot of extra money at the end of the night. And you can bring wine and a picnic, and I don't even ask you to share. Oh, it's on our west lawn. We have a lovely west lawn area that's very nicely shaded. And even on a 90-degree day at 7 o'clock when the concerts start, it's nice and cool because the grass never even gets sunlight on it. So it stays nice and cool. So, was there another question? Yes?
Has this been restored?
No. The woodwork is original. Our architect is W.W. Boynton. His other buildings that you know are the Chicago Water Tower, right by Water Tower Place, the Joliet State Penitentiary from the first scene of the Blues Brothers. So we have a little Hollywood connection there, like you need. And he finished the Illinois State Capitol because was Pinkenard was the original designer of that, and he passed away during the construction. So Boynton finished it. Our interiors are done by a man named August Fiedler. He is who designed all of the woodwork, or the majority of the woodwork. And the textiles and furniture were designed by a man named George Shasty. And those of you who are somewhat local will see in the paper, hopefully in the next couple days, because the press release went out, that our Shasty drawings are going to be on display at the Met starting the 14th, I know, starting the 14th of December. We had the only drawings. There was a lot of furniture out on the east coast of Shasty's, but we had the drawings, so they borrowed them. So we're excited about that. Anyone else? Okay, well with that, and without further ado, because I think you're probably sick of me by now, I will turn this over. You ready? Okay, you're waving at me like, is that good? Did you get the nap that you wanted? Awesome, very, very good. Okay, so I will turn it over to Pilot Island.
Welcome to Hegla Karras Mansion, a home with well over a century's worth of stories, memories, and histories. As we're gathered here on a dark December night, try to imagine how the family may have spent a cold winter evening in 1947. The war had been over for a few years, and folks were busy starting families and powering the factories, farms, and businesses that would make the country great. With a bit of disposable income in their pockets, most households could afford a radio. After the work was done for the day, when the family sat together in the parlor, tucked away from the elements of a Midwest winter, they may have listened to a program like the one you are about to hear. Now, there are three ways you can enjoy tonight's presentation. You can watch with your eyes open to get a sense of what it might have been like to have been part of the studio audience. Or you can close your eyes and immerse yourself in the story, letting your imagination take over. Or maybe a combination. Just don't go to sleep on us, please. Whatever you choose, we hope you will enjoy The Case of the Christmas Cactus.
Present The Casebook of Bobber Maxwell, Two-Fisted Detective. Tonight's episode, The Case of the Christmas Cactus. Following his dramatic scuffle the previous week with Turkish crime lord Konstantin Bilgi and the bringing of that international villain to justice, our hero, Bobber Maxwell, finds himself...
So, I found myself heading back to the office on an evening in late December. It was cold as the coffee down at Louis, and starting to snow again. If I had any brains, I'd have hailed a cab. Ah, well, like my ma always said, what are you crying about?
Paper! Get your paper here!
Well, you know, my old pal Swifty, still out there selling his papers no matter what the weather.
Paper, mister? Oh, it's you, Mr. Maxwell. Evening paper?
You bet, Swifty. Keep the change. An early Christmas present.
Ah, oh, gee, thanks, Mr. Maxwell. Are you sure you don't want three more copies of the paper?
I'm sure. So, yeah, you getting ready for Christmas?
Shucks, I guess. But you know Santa's afraid to come into my neighborhood, Mr.
M. All right. But you're going to come to the big party at the community center, ain't you?
I wouldn't miss it. I heard they even talked you into being one of Santa's helpers.
Let's just say someone talked me into being there. I'm not wearing any jingle bells, but if you play your cards right, I will have access to that sack of toys.
It's a deal. Well, gotta run.
Great kid. What a character. If only Swifty had stuck around for a few seconds more. Hold on there, miss!
Oh!
Are you all right?
Yes, sorry. Hey, listen, can you help me? I'm being chased by two men.
Oh, if it's a fight they want.
I have to get away from here. They won't bother with you. But I need you to take this package. Hide it for me. What's your name?
Bobber Maxwell. I've got an office just on the street.
I'll find you. Please don't unwrap that package, whatever you do.
Hey, wait a minute. What's your name?
I'll find you.
I wouldn't learn her name till later. But that was my first meeting with Arlene Cavanaugh. Pure class and gorgeous. Her sparks could restart the Chicago fire. Unfortunately, she wasn't kidding about her boyfriends. No sooner had she disappeared, and I had covered the package in my newspaper, when those two mugs came galloping out of the storm.
Hey, pal, you seen a dame run past, red half fur coat?
Duh, I don't think you could
tell what color hair she had with that hat on.
Shut up, stupid.
The only thing I've seen coming down the sidewalk is you two gorillas.
Oh, a Mr. Funny Man, huh? Out Christmas shopping? What you got wrapped up in that newspaper, Funny Man?
Your mother's girdle. She told me she needed it for the Christmas ball.
Dude, come on, boys. This guy don't know nothing. She's getting away.
You're lucky we got pressing business, Funny Man. I know just how to deal with guys like you.
Hey, what's your mother's address? I've still got to deliver this thing. After that encounter with the Chuckle Boys, you'd better believe I legged it over to my office pronto. Now, I've been warned not to open that package, so once inside, I opened the package. I had to know what I was getting involved with. I figured a couple fresh pieces of cellophane tape and who would be the wiser? Ah, so much for carefulness. When I finally got the paper off, well, it was the last thing you'd expect. A potted cactus plant. Not some rubber dime store gewgaw. It was an actual living plant, like something you'd find growing in Death Valley. And this was no ordinary cactus either. It was decorated with little Christmas ornaments and tinsel, like something Santa would have brought back with him from his vacation in Palm Springs. But no sooner had I gotten that cactus unwrapped when my two pals, Frick and Freck, suddenly appeared out of thin air. And now, I don't mean those thugs on the street. I guess I haven't mentioned Frick and Freck before, have I? They're pretty hard to describe. Shortly after the war, they started showing up, visiting me from time to time.
Good evening, Mr. Maxwell.
Mr. Maxwell.
Only I could see them, evidently. They tried many times to teach me their real names, but it always came out of my mouth as Frick and Frack, so that's who they were as far as I was concerned. They told me they were from some other planet. And now, I know there have been a lot in the news lately about flying saucers crashing in the desert, but that was nothing but baloney to me. The way I had it figured, they must have been like my guardian angels or something. They were always giving me advice anyway. Oh, you two. What do you want? Can't you see I'm busy?
That's an interesting plant you have there, Mr. Maxwell.
Yes, interesting.
Yeah, it's fascinating.
Wherever did you come by such a remarkable plant?
Remarkable plant.
From Tarzan the Plant Man. He was having a big succulent sale.
Oh, Mr. Maxwell, you and your little jokes.
Little jokes.
Why do I somehow get the feeling you two already know where I got this cactus?
We do keep an eye on you.
Yeah, that's right, my guardian angels.
Yes, as you say. But I would advise you keep that plant wrapped as the lady said requested.
Requested.
Just a second. Yep.
Mr. Maxwell?
Yes? Who is this?
I'm Ilsa, Arlene's nanny. Do you have it? Arlene says you have it.
Have what? Who's Arlene?
The package she gave you tonight.
Well, the cactus?
You opened it? Don't cough. After she told you not to? Arlene is a singer over at the Cagey Canale. She needs you to bring it to her.
Look, lady, you can't just shove something into a stranger's hands. And...
you gotta come with us now.
Hello? Hello?
We'll return to more of the case of the Christmas cactus. But first, a word from our sponsor, Hans Brinker Floor Wax. Ladies, is your kitchen floor yellow and dull? Does it feel like you're walking on a tar paper roof? That's the problem our friend Claire had. So she decided to visit her sister Jenny, whose floors were always so clean and shiny.
More coffee, Claire.
Yes, please, Jenny.
Here you go.
Thanks. Say, Jenny, my husband Jeff hates our kitchen floor. I've noticed how clean and shiny yours always is, though. How do you do it?
Why, it's like walking on a frozen lake. Funny you should call it a frozen lake, Claire. I always use Hans Brinker floor wax. It's the only floor wax that turns your kitchen floor into the Zuider Zee. You know, that frozen lake in Holland that Hans Brinker skated across? Look, it says so right on the bottle.
Turns your kitchen floor into the Zuider Zee. Well, it certainly looks
looks like a skating pond in here.
And Ted just loves it. Wait, here he is now. You can ask him yourself. Ted, in here.
Hi, Jenny. Oh, hi there, Claire. I'm
Wow, what a slide. I don't need any more convincing. I'm going to run out right now and buy a bottle at my local retailer.
Here, Claire, take my spare bottle. And Merry Christmas.
Thank you so much, Jenny. I can't wait to do this for my husband.
Bring your floor straight outdoors, it's no mystery. Use Housebreaker and you'll swear you're at the Cider Z.
Look for my silver skates on the bottle.
And now, back to our adventure, Bobber Maxwell in the case of the Christmas cactus.
After that Ilsa Dame screamed and our phone call was cut off, I realized I was in a pot of pretty hot soup. I wrapped that cactus back up in its original gift wrap, some shiny metallic stuff, and I also covered that again with Swifty's newspaper, and I hit the streets. So, this Arlene was a singer? I hopped a cab down to the Cajun Canary to hear for myself. Maybe Ilsa had been lying. Maybe this was a trap. But as my ma always said, stop worrying about everything and get out of here. I'd never been to the Cajun Canary, but as the cab pulled up to it, I realized it was everything I'd heard about it. A swankier hideaway you'd never find.
Check your hat and coat, sir?
Inside, as the girl at the counter went to hang my hat and coat, I quickly looked around. There was a shelf filled with a bunch of different Christmas decorations and floral arrangements. Making sure that I wasn't being watched, I pulled all the paper layers off the cactus and stuck that prickly thing in amongst the rest of the holiday frou-frou. Then, as I went in to find the bar, I saw, big as life, that Ilsa hadn't been kidding about one thing at least. A sign on a placard declared, featuring the song stylings of Miss Arlene Cavanaugh. And under that was a photo of the very woman who had stuck me with that cactus.
Cigars? Cigarettes? Chewing gum? Cigars? Cane Vista? Cigarettes?
Nah, I gave that stuff up years ago. Hey, you got any cashews there?
Cashews?
Yeah, you know, those little curly-shaped nuts.
My nuts. Cigars? Cigarettes?
And no sooner had a bourbon in my hand when Arlene Cavanaugh was introduced. She stepped up to the microphone and made with the torch song. And she sang like a bird.
You left me at Christmas, only heartache to wrap. I'm the La Coupe-ismus, and I feel like a sap.
When she had finished her song, I caught her eye and motioned for her to join me at the bar. She didn't seem as pleased to see me as I had expected.
What are you doing here? I told you I'd find you.
Hey, if you're not careful, you'll hurt my feelings. What are you drinking?
Nothing when I'm working except water. Booze dries out my voice.
Water it is. Water for her. We should make things look as natural as possible, just in case we're being watched.
So, why are you here? Is the package safe? How did you find out where I work?
Well, I'm here because your landlady said you wanted me to bring the package to you. She told me where to find you. I hate to say, she may need help.
What landlady?
A German woman. She called my office. And then, well, it sounded like the same two thugs that were chasing you broke down her door and attacked her. I think she said her name was Ilsa.
I'm living with my sister and her husband. They don't have a landlady. This Ilsa is a former Nazi. She's been after that package, too.
Well, how did she know to contact me?
Before I came down to the club, I called my sister and had her write your name down for me so I wouldn't forget it. One of Ilsa's agents must have seen me in the phone booth without the package. Must have tricked my sister Carol into telling your name. I hope she's all right. We're dealing with ruthless people.
Ruthless? Say, suppose you spill some more, like what this is all about.
I know. I owe you that much for dragging you into this. But first, where is it? Is it safe?
The cactus? Yeah, it's safe.
You opened it?
Hey, take it easy. Now that's funny. Miss Ilsa said the same thing. But if she's not your landlady or a friend, then how did she know you told me not to open it?
It was something else I mentioned to Carol on the phone. Mm.
Well, lady, 10-1, they've got your sister's telephone line tapped. Now, what's this all about? She started singing, only this time, it wasn't a torch song. What a strange tale it was, too. Her father was a scientist working for the government out in the deserts of New Mexico. He recently sent her the cactus plant wrapped in special paper and told her to hide it for him and not tell a soul that someone was after it. But someone squealed someone, and now all these other criminal elements wanted it. Everyone from a prominent Chicago gangster to a bunch of lousy ex-Nazis. And the reason Arlene didn't want me to unwrap it was because of something hidden in the dirt the cactus was planted in. Something that needed to be wrapped in special paper. Uh-oh, I thought. I was pretty sure I knew where I had stashed that paper, but I made a note to myself to go back and check.
So you see, when I pushed that package into your hands, I didn't even know you were a private detective. You were just the first honest-looking face I ran into.
Yeah. All my years in the boxing ring never prepared me for this lucky day.
You say the package is somewhere nearby, but you're sure it's safe. And you did wrap it up back again, I hope. I said you wrapped it back up again, right?
Mr. Maxwell, we found you.
Found you?
Not again.
Who are you talking to?
What? Oh, that cigarette girl over your shoulder there.
Who, Dolores? Dolores, can you come over here a second? I think my friend needs something.
Sure thing, Miss Cavanaugh. Oh, it's you, Mr. Cashew. What do you want?
Do you have any, pistachios?
What is it with you and nuts? Stop wasting my time. Sorry, Miss Cavanaugh. Cigars? Cigarettes?
Mr. Maxwell, right now, it's very important you listen to us.
Listen to us?
Those two men who were asking on the street, they're headed this way and almost here.
Almost here.
What?
Now who are you talking to?
Listen, sister, there's no time to explain how I know, and I really mean no time. But those two throwbacks who chased you, they're on their way here.
Then I've got to leave. Here's my sister's address. Meet me there later tonight. I'm done singing for now.
Watch yourself.
Mr. Maxwell, we saw where you hid that plant.
Saw where you hid it.
And I may say it was a very foolish hiding place.
Stupid, actually.
And it really needs to be rewrapped in Professor Cavanaugh's special foil-lined paper.
Foil-lined.
You two seem to know an awful lot about this cactus.
We admit. We had a special interest in it, but those two men...
I know, they're coming. I remember, I stashed that fancy paper behind a wastebasket. Let's go rewrap your precious cactus. So I returned to the lobby and asked for my hat and coat. And while the girl was retrieving them, I grabbed the cactus and quickly did a rewrap number on it the best I could. But no sooner had I finished when guess who burst through the doors?
Don't let anybody through those doors, stupid. Okay, punk, give me that package, nice and easy like. I hate to plug you in a civilized place like this.
Why don't you try taking it from me, Junior?
Don't let him have the cactus, Mr. Maxwell. He mustn't have it.
He mustn't.
I'll do my best, but here's an idea. Why don't you two help me?
Right, you asked for it, funny man.
You hit him with it, boys. He's holding a plant in one hand.
I'm trying to hit this guy. Like a jackrabbit.
Had enough, Junior?
Shoot him!
Boss, I thought you said no guard play in the club.
Forget that, shoot him!
Look out!
Not so funny now. Here, stupid, grab that package. Let's run for it. Mr. Maxwell, we have to leave.
I'm leaving.
You know, Maybe those guys aren't angels.
We'll have more on the case of the Christmas cactus, but first a word from our sponsor. Hansbrinker Floor Wax, the only floor wax that turns your kitchen floor into the Zyderzee, proudly announces their big annual theme contest. It's so easy to enter. How do you do it exactly? Our friend Claire has the same question. Let's listen in as she visits her sister Jenny once again.
Hi, Jenny. Say Jeff loves our new Hansbrinker kitchen floor.
How is he feeling?
Great. And the cast comes off next week.
Thanks for asking.
But say, what is that you're doing?
Funny you should ask. I'm entering the Hansbrinker Floor Wax Big Holiday Contest.
I would love to enter that, but is entering difficult?
It couldn't be easier. All you need to do is steam off the labels from four bottles of Hansbrinker Floor Wax. Once the labels are dry, set a heavy book on them to flatten them. Next, fill out an entry form for the contest. I got mine from our local retailer. Then, write an essay, 2,000 words or more, type in double space, on this year's theme, what Hansbrinker Floor Wax means to me. Next, have the whole thing notarized. Everyone knows a notary. Make out four $1 bills for the entry fee, and mail the whole thing to the address on the entry form, postmarked by midnight of December 24th.
Say, that is easy. I'll enter this afternoon. But what are the prizes like?
Well, we won first prize last year, and let's just say it was enough money to buy our new Rolls Royce. Ted just loves it. Here's Ted now.
Always use Hansbrinker, your floor wax of choice. Win a contest and you might be driving a Rolls Royce.
Look for my silver skates on the entry form.
And now, the conclusion of our adventure, Bob or Maxwell in the case of the Christmas cactus.
You'd think after getting shot that I'd have laid there like a good boy and waited for the cops to come with their questions and those medics would just be itching to stuff me into a nice fat ambulance. But not me. Like my mom always said, if it's one thing you're not, it's a good boy. No, before the party could arrive, I sucked it up and headed out into the storm. It was dark, so I was able to keep the cabbie from noticing my bloody coat. But once I was back at the office, with the use of a nail file, tweezers, gauze, adhesive tape, and a great big bottle of rubbing alcohol, all of which I like to call my detective's tire repair kit, I was able to dig the slug out of my shoulder and patch myself up. If I needed a doctor, there'd be time enough for that later. Right now, I had a score to settle. In a fresh set of clothes, I was back on the streets. No one back at the Cajun Canary knew my name, other than Arlene. So I was pretty sure I'd get no well-meaning assistance from the cops. But at the moment, I only had one thing to go on. Arlene's sister Carol's address. So I made a beeline there. I had the cabbie drop me off about a block away. Carol's house was in a residential area in the middle of Logan Square. As I approached, slogging through the snow of the unshoveled sidewalk, it looked at first like there was no one at home. But all the footprints leading up to the house told a different story. And as I added my footprints to the rest of the mess, I could see a glow of light from a back basement window. The snow was too deep back there, so I took a chance on the deserted-looking enclosed front porch. I had just slipped inside that porch when I froze. The interior door slowly opened. I slid to the side, keeping out of sight, when who should come out but my old buddy Junior, his face partially revealed by the lit cigarette in his mouth. Clearly, he had been told to keep a lookout. Hiya, Junior. Miss me?
What?
Nighty-night, Junior. I played him a little chin music and tucked him in for the night. You never knew what hit him. I gagged and tied him up good to a porch pillar. He wouldn't freeze out there too badly. I quietly entered the house, but it seemed anyone who was anyone must be at the big party downstairs. Without too much trouble, I found the basement door standing wide open. Sure enough, there was light coming up the stairs and a loud, sinister voice speaking.
I told you, Miss Cavanaugh, I don't hear the letters from you really.
The stairway was enclosed and paneling, so anyone coming down would be hidden. I took a couple hesitant steps, hoping those old stairs wouldn't start with the creaks. And the first person I saw was Arlene. She was tied to a chair. She glanced up in my direction, and there was nothing but fear in her eyes. I could hear the speaker more clearly now, and I really hoped it wasn't who I thought it might be.
I want answers, and I better get them quick, or everybody down here is gonna be mighty sorry.
Soundlessly, I took a couple more steps down and managed my first peek around the paneling. There were Arlene, what were probably her sister Carolyn's husband, a blonde woman I took to be that German dame Ilsa, all tied to different chairs. There was Junior's pal, the one he called stupid, the one who shot me. He was holding a gun on everyone with his back to me. And shooting his mouth off was the very person I was afraid I'd see. Nico DiNola, the biggest hood in the Windy City. And in the middle of everybody, set on a stool, was that cactus, the cause of this whole mess. And it was unwrapped. But by far, the strangest element of this weird scene was the presence of frickin' Frack. Clearly invisible to everyone but me, they stood on either side of the cactus with their hands extended toward it, as if the cactus were a campfire and they were warming themselves. They seemed to sense me peeking around the paneling because they each turned their heads and looked up at me.
Forgive us, Mr. Maxwell, but as you can see, we are very busy.
Very busy.
Well, didn't this take the cake? There was no time to figure out what frickin' Frack were up to. I hate unholstering my .38. And you'd think this would be the perfect time to make an exception. But both Nico and his henchman, Stupid, had pieces out. My bringing a third into the picture might just get someone killed. And my shoulder was already aching enough. No, Nico said he wanted answers, and I would give him some, even if I had to make them up.
Nobody's got anything to say?
I told you. My associates only know it has something to do with racketry. But we have scientists who can tell us a lot more if you will let them examine the cactus. You know, you would benefit much more if only you became partners with us.
I told you, I'm not partner with any Nazi scum like you. I'm not buying that racketry malarkey. How can a plant fly a rocket? No, if that thing is so valuable, it must be for another reason. Someone in this room knows. I think we should try phoning your father again, Miss Cavanaugh. And this time, let's hope for your sake. He's home.
But I've already told you. Even if he does answer his phone, I'm not sure he has all the information you want.
No way. I figure if he went to the trouble of having you hide it for him, he must know a lot more. And if I'm going to sell this thing to the highest bidder, I'll need to know everything about that cactus. Same as your pops.
I can tell you everything you need to know about the cactus.
What? You? I thought I plugged you good.
Almost, friend. Hey, watch where you wave that thing. See? Hands above my head. I'm clearly unarmed.
I don't believe it. Bob and Maxwell, we meet again.
You know this creep, Mr. DiNola?
Bob and I have had a little scrapes. And now you say you have answers regarding this plant? When did you become a scientist, Bob?
Didn't you hear? I got my degree from the University of What Do You Care?
Always that mouth of yours. Mighty brave talk for someone with two guns pointed at him.
Do you want to hear about the cactus or not?
I haven't shot you yet. I also hope you remember I once lost an awful lot of dough because of you, because I sure haven't.
Don't worry, I know plenty. And you can't pull this info out of my brain if my brain is attached to a dead body. So, what I want is a trade. My info for a piece of the action.
What are you doing, Mr. Maxwell?
What are you doing?
And I thought yours was an honest face.
Hey, Maxwell, you would do much better to join my associates, wouldn't you?
No thanks, lady. If there's one thing Nico and I happen to agree on, it's the subject of scumbag Nazis.
You'll call us scumbags, but he is ready to sell the cactus secret to the highest bidding scumbag.
Well, Ilsa, there are scumbags and there are scumbags. Okay, Barbara, I'm through playing around. I'm not going to guarantee any deal for you. But if what you know is good, I'll consider it. What is it you do know?
Okay, I'm lowering my hands.
Okay, but be on your best behavior.
First of all, you have to understand what it is you really have. There's a device in the dirt of that cactus. A device that comes from outer space.
What?
No!
Mr. Maxwell, stop!
Stop!
Not only that, but it belongs to a couple of little men from outer space. Nobody else can see them except me. They follow me around. I figure with their outer space science, they somehow knew that this device was going to fall into my hands. Maybe they could tell the future. And they wanted to get this thing back once I got it. They needed to get back to their planet, I don't know. But then you guys took it from me.
Really, Baba? You couldn't think of anything better? Little men from outer space?
I know, it sounds nuts. But they're here right now. They're right on either side of the cactus. There and there.
Please don't!
No!
Here, I'll show you the device. It's right here.
Baba, no!
There. See?
Well, I'll be. Let me see that thing.
You got it, brother.
Oh, my hand!
Hey, you!
Oh,
oh.
Oh. Oh, Bobber, you knocked both of them out.
Yeah, and I only got shot one more time.
Mr. Maxwell, someone needs to wrap the device back up in the foil. Your city might explode.
Where'd I go?
Arlene, here. Let me cut these ropes with my penknife.
Thank you. That was quite an act. For a moment.
Listen, could you wrap the foil around the device again? Frickin' Fred, we're having a conniption over here.
Oh, right. Hey, you weren't kidding about the little man.
Afraid not. Yeah, let me untie your sister and brother-in-law. I'll need the rope for Nico and his gunman here.
Great job, Mr. Maxwell. But you can relax. My men and I will take it from here. Come on, fellas, get these two off of the floor and out of here. Untie Miss Nazi over there and take her into custody as well.
Swifty? Why are you dressed like that? Who are these guys?
Well, we'll see the last of us.
No, we'll get you.
Sorry, I can never come clean with you before, Mr. M. Let me properly introduce myself. I'm Stephen Swifty Broderick, special agent with the Secret Service. Working undercover the last 2 years as Swifty the newsboy.
Oh, poor Carol and Brian.
Go ahead and untie and ungag them, Miss
Kavanaugh. Swifty? You a G-man? I can hardly believe it. How old are you?
Actually, I'll be 37 in May.
What a disguise! Why, come to think of it, you did seem to need a shave sometimes. Hey, I'm gonna miss that kid you used to be.
Yeah, I always enjoyed our little chats. By the way, my men are radioing to get an ambulance for your gunshot wound.
Mr. Maxwell, ask him if everything is safe now.
Safe now?
Swifty, please tell me, what is this really all about? Do you know about the two?
Do I know about the two men from outer space?
Yeah. Team?
If they're here with us now, we can tell them all is good, and we'll be shipping their engine component back.
We heard. Farewell, Mr. Maxwell. It's been a pleasure getting to know you all these years. We'll be back to visit you one day.
When you least expected.
They heard you and now they just disappeared.
They were never actually here. It's gonna be difficult to explain.
and it was difficult. But Agent Swifty did his best. It was amazing how much I had gotten right during my big bluff. Frick and Frack, Swifty couldn't say their real names either, were from another planet. Only this planet was a lot farther away than the ones we learn about in school. They were visiting Earth during the last days of the war. And, wouldn't you know, even with all the advanced technology in their spaceship, some lousy Nazi gunner got lucky and shot them out of the sky. They crashed in a farm field. But a group of Americans got to them first and were able to get them and their spaceship transported to the United States, to the scientific laboratories where Arlene's father was the top dog. The American scientists tried to help the little space guys fix their ship, but with our primitive resources, it literally took years. In the meantime, Frick and Frack had another device that could see into the future, sort of. It couldn't see everything, but one thing seemed to come through loud and clear, that I would end up with an important part of their space engine, and that it would be in great danger.
And this is a part that's really hard to understand. They were able to project themselves to where you were, all the way from New Mexico, and make friends with you. However, even though they could appear to someone from a great distance, it was only to one person at a time, and they could never touch anything here physically. So, I was assigned to keep an eye on you and be their hands when they needed it.
They did have the ability to keep that engine part from exploding outside of its protective foil, but they could only do it for so long. Anyway, some Nazi spies learned about all this, broke into the labs, and nearly stole this dangerous engine part. But Arlene's father saved it in the nick of time and, using his scientific noodle at a florist shop, quickly bought a Christmas cactus where he hid the part and mailed it to Arlene in Chicago. And, well, I guess you know the rest. After explaining all this, Swifty promised to bring his own kids to the community Christmas party. Can you believe it? He's okay, that Agent Swifty. And right around the time he had to leave with that spaceship part, my ambulance arrived. So I had to say my reluctant goodbyes to Arlene Cavanaugh.
Oh, look on the floor there. The poor little Christmas cactus pulled out of its dirt. Do you think that engine part made it radioactive?
I don't know, but it stuck me good. As Ma always said, you're gonna grab needles, expect to get needled. Swifty didn't seem worried. If it was dangerous, he would have taken it.
Maybe we could replant it, spruce up those little ornaments.
You know, that thing would make a great door prize for some occasion. And I know just the Christmas party. Interested?
I thought you'd never ask.
Somebody down there needs an ambulance?
I thought you'd never ask.
Barbara Maxwell, the two-fisted detective, was brought to you by Hans Brinker Floor Wax, the only floor wax that turns your kitchen floor into designer Z. Tune in again next week for another exciting adventure from the casebook of Barbara Maxwell, two-fisted detective.
Peace on earth and mercy. surprise. Join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Bethlehem, homes of peace.
Thank you. I'm still there. sun is always
shining.
I think
it's warm.
I've seen a promo. Are you Wendy's dad?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
I'm Marge. It's so nice to meet you finally. Glad you enjoyed.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
See, you would have froze.
Very, very good thing.